Hi, it's Mrs. Glenn, principal of Pasco eSchool. We've been getting a lot of great questions in through the district's social media and Let's Talk forums, and I wanted to take a few minutes to respond to some of the frequently asked questions. One popular question we're getting is whether students can use mobile devices like iPads or phones to access online coursework while schools are closed. The answer is that many of the activities will be compatible with mobile devices, but not all of them. Students will need some access to a computer to handle assignments that require a lot of writing, and some of the course content from our digital publishers includes Flash, which is not compatible with Apple devices like an iPad or an iPhone. What happens with students that have special needs or an IEP during the time of school closure? I appreciate that question because we have thousands of students in our district who get accommodations for education plans, whether it's a 504 plan, an IEP, if they're an English language learner, or medical needs. We have a variety of students for whom we make adjustments to the instructional plan throughout our schools. So the answer is that truly, this is uncharted territory for our state and for our school district, and we're still fine-tuning some answers because, just like you would expect, each student is an individual, and so we need to look very carefully at their needs. So here's what we've already done to help large numbers of students who need accommodation. In our platform, which is My Learning, we have a tool that plugs in called Read Speaker. This tool allows the content on the screen to be read aloud in English or any one of about 60 languages. And it will also highlight and include some other text features that will help students who may struggle a little with their reading or reading comprehension, or students in lower grades who may need some reading supports. So we know that that tool will help meet a variety of needs for education plans. Another accommodation that is a part of our model with distance learning, and now I'm putting on my Pasco eSchool principal hat, is that we already have the ability to give flexible scheduling and additional time within the school day for students who may need a little bit of adjustment to their learning plans and deadlines. I do want to be clear that extended time is not unlimited time. So there will still be deadlines or timelines provided to students within the courses, and then their teachers and case managers will follow up with adjustments and additional instructions for students whose situations require that. But it is not going to be permissible for students to simply not show progress consistently during this time period when schools are closed. Finally, and behind the scenes, even though it's spring break, we have teams that are hard at work preparing guidance documents for our school staff who function as case managers and support staff for students in some of our special education programs. And so when we return to work next week, even though we're not coming into our buildings, we will be having a series of meetings and updating staff on some of the guidance from the state and national levels about how we can support students who may need accommodations while we are in a period of remote learning. So stay tuned for updates, and when school staff return to work and have had a chance to go through the training to get ready, then they will be touch points for you and points of contact to talk through your concerns and create plans to help your students be successful and get as many of the services that we can provide during this period of social distancing. I know that it's a big concern, and I promise you that it has been front in our minds as we have begun to put the pieces in place to support our schools. So keep these great questions coming. We're excited to have the opportunity to keep you looped in. Thank you. The question is, how much time are students expected to work each day? That's a great one. And the answer to that is that our students will be engaged in learning activities for a time period that is comparable to a standard school day. This means that we are planning for our learners to have about 5 hours of activities per day. But it's important to note that the time periods are flexible. We are designing a model that is what we call asynchronous, meaning that we do not all have to be online and learning at the same time, because we understand that all of our families are making some big adjustments to the workspaces and the schedules and the routines that are typical of our school year operation. That includes my own family. We're struggling too, and we're trying to figure out how our new normal is going to be. So the short answer is there will be learning activities that would define about 5 hours a day. Not all of those will require students to be actively logged into the learning management system. However, there are physical activities that will have students out in the fresh air or completing, you know, physical activities and movement in the house. And there will be some, you know, reading assignments and things like that that will allow our students to take a break from screen time, because we think that that's important. And of course, then there'll be online activities as well. Again, those materials and experiences are designed to be asynchronous, meaning that it's not necessary to plan for your learners to be seated and logged in at specific times. Although we imagine that some of our teachers will begin offering webinar opportunities to connect in real time using webcam access. And so, you know, those will be advertised and available to help maintain that school-home connection. But students will be able to work throughout the day and even into the evening, because we know that we have families who may have multiple students at home. And so we'll have to have flexibility as we develop the new routines. So thanks so much for that great question. I know it's on everyone's mind. The Glenn family is struggling with it too, and we're going to work out some options to keep my own 12-year-old and 16-year-old students working as they can't go to school either. So I feel your pain and have some of the same questions about how that's going to impact our family. And so just know that as you're working with school staff, we're also struggling to turn our own personal routines around and have a lot of the same questions and concerns that you do too. So we'll get through it together. And if you're struggling and need some ideas, we want to keep this dialogue going with our friends and our community. So send those questions in or reach out when we're back in the office. In the meantime, I hope you're enjoying your last day of spring break. It seems like it's been a blur. Take care. The question is, can students in the same home share a device? And the answer is yes, that's possible. I understand that it could be challenging, but it is possible to create a work schedule for your students that would allow them to share a device. Our learning activities are designed to be completed asynchronously, which means that they are not time-bound. And so students can log in and complete them really anytime 24/7, but realistically within the time frames and the routines in your household. So if that requires that students in your home share a device, then I would just suggest that you create a schedule that would allow them to take turns and give them also some time away from the screen. So they have physical activities that will be a part of their learning activities each day. Maybe give them some chores. Think of how clean our homes can be if we give our kids chores, or just encourage them to get out and get some fresh air from time to time. So I hope that I have answered that question and maybe started those wheels turning. I'll just share that the Glenn household has two students, 12 years old and 16 years old, and we are trying to figure out how we're going to create those structures in our home as well. So if I come up with some great tools and advice, I will absolutely share those out with you guys. And perhaps in response to this video, some of our families who have experience with full-time virtual learning, some of my Pasco eSchool Ninja Nation, or folks who have experience with more than one student sharing a device, can chime in and share some things that have worked. We look forward to continuing the conversation as we all enter this new phase and uncharted territory. It's definitely going to require some patience and flexibility for all of us, but I want you to know that all Pasco Schools employees are right in the same boat with you. We are struggling to figure out how we're going to structure the new home and family life to support learning activities as a significant part of our days too. Here's another question that folks have been wondering. Is the schoolwork that we're planning to deliver during our remote learning or digital learning period done live, like in a traditional classroom? And I want to say that it is not. In nearly every case, the courses are designed to be delivered asynchronously. And we did that deliberately because we knew that we would have families whose schedules needed flexibility. We'd have families who had multiple children in the home. And so we wanted to create a system in which our students and our staff had flexibility, and we limited the additional stress of everybody having to be at a specific place at a specific time. Now, teachers have the ability to host webinar sessions, and so they may engage in some activities in real time with their students who can join them, but they can also record those. So if it doesn't work with your schedule, or if you have two students in your home and the webinar sessions conflict, know that they'll still have access to those lessons or interactions outside of the scheduled time. But we are trying to create the most flexible option to meet a variety of needs. And so, if there are some challenges that you're encountering as we roll this out next week, actually, my apologies, it'll be on the 31st. We're rolling it out with staff next week, so they're ready to begin instruction on the 31st. But as you're developing those routines and procedures, if there are some challenges, I hope you'll share them with us so that we can help you and give some thought. Chances are good if it's a little bit of a challenge or an uphill battle in your home, there are lots of other people feeling the same thing. And so this gives us an opportunity to get some heads thinking on the problem with you and maybe make some adjustments or some suggestions that can help you. So in the meantime, if you have any additional questions, I hope you'll continue to reach out. These are some really good ones that I'm sure a lot of people are wondering. Thanks again. Here's a question that I know hits very close to home for the Glenn family. What are working parents supposed to do? And that is a struggle. You know, I'm a school principal, and even though I do run our district's virtual school, I go into the office every day, or at least I did. And so we're based on the campus of Cruz Lake Middle School. And so I leave every day, or did, to go into work. And my husband works from home, and our two children go to school. We have a 12-year-old and a 16-year-old. So now my poor husband is having to share workspace with three new coworkers, and we're trying to figure out how we are going to juggle our parenting responsibilities with the oversight and supervision for our own children who will be learning remotely as well. So the truth is, we don't really have great answers because this situation is uncharted territory for our country, for our district, for our state, and many of the supports that we rely on to be able to go outside of the home and work are not available. Things like daycares and school. Even though it's not our primary function, let's be realistic. Many families count on school playing a big role in the supervision and engagement piece while families work. So I think I would suggest a couple of things as we navigate this new chapter for a little while, and I hope it will be just a little while. The first thing is to be flexible and to be positive. I think for us in the Glenn household, I'm trying to tread lightly and let my kids enjoy their last day or two of spring break, but we're going to have to sit down and we're going to have to set some ground rules in our house about routines and work times and norms. So a little glimpse behind the scenes here at the Glenn household, it's, you know, my husband is not an educator, so it's a work day for him. And I've been working behind the scenes over spring break with our district team to get our content available and ready for us to start teaching on the 31st. But my children are on spring break. And you know, so it is hard sometimes when my kids have questions or needs that they think are urgent, or actually are urgent, for them to respect the fact that I may be on a conference call or my husband may be in the middle of a task for his job. And so we're going to have to talk about some, you know, some boundaries and some expectations around how we interact with each other when it's their school time and our work time. So I would encourage you to think about some of those pieces. And I think it depends on the age of your students. So we're going to be sharing some tools out with parents that allow or suggest some schedules that have worked with my families whose students choose to go to school full-time online. And I will encourage my Ninja Nation folks to chime in on social media posts with this video and share some things that work for you. In our elementary households, and when my own children were young, it helped for us to tag team, my husband and I. So when I was a teacher who taught online, we would create chunks of time, and it may be an option in some families for you to trade responsibilities among family members. If you have young learners at home, maybe one person takes the lead at helping to keep them focused on their learning activities, while the other adults tend to work responsibilities or household responsibilities. Maybe you can build in some time where students have a little bit of independent time where they might read or play outside or engage in, you know, whatever their preferred activity is. For my children, it would be gaming or, you know, chatting and texting on the phone. So you could think about creating little chunks of time where if they do what is required, let's say in their language arts block, then they could have, you know, a time period where they get their choice of activity. For older learners, we find that it works a little bit better if they plan a schedule where they focus in on two or three classes. They start off with their more difficult class and work their way toward classes that are their preferred or more interesting subjects. And again, it does not work really well if you plant yourself in a seat and don't move for several hours. So setting timers to get up and move and handle chores, get outside and take a walk, you know, read, maybe watch a little TV or play video games for a period of time, and then get back into the groove and crank out another little chunk of time. Those are some strategies that tend to work for my full-time online learners. And when my son, who is 16 years old, took online courses over the summer, it helped for us to set some expectations and check in frequently on what he was doing. You know, it is a temptation when you're on the computer to flip into another tab and do something else that's not related to what you're supposed to accomplish. I think we can all relate. Sometimes when I have work tasks I need to be doing, especially in the evenings, it's really tempting for me to go into another tab and, you know, shop or read news or really do something else, because just mentally I'm getting a little tired and I don't want to engage in something that I may not want to be doing. So be patient with each other, be flexible with each other, be prepared to start off with one schedule on the week of the 30th that you think is going to work and find out it's not working and make an adjustment to it. It's likely because many of us are not used to being at home this much and not used to being together this much, that we're going to have to give each other a little bit of grace and talk through some of the challenges It's easy to do something and not realize that it causes a problem for somebody else. And so, definitely talk with each other and be clear about what you will need to be successful in meeting whatever obligations are ahead of you. So hope this helps. I hope to hear from some of my experienced online families who can maybe share some tips with families who are, you know, engaged in remote learning now, just out of necessity, and could use some lessons learned from those who've gone before them. So thanks so much for your attention. Hope this helped.